This is the voice of Admin, and this is the live Clancast. We're coming to you live from central London, and you are, well, anywhere in the whole world, actually. And there's one thing that unites us today, and that is the fact that we love Michelle Paver's writings. And we are delighted to have Michelle with us this afternoon. Good afternoon, Michelle.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Thanks for coming.
And in addition to Michelle, we've got another person who I think some people actually wondered whether he exists or not. Is he just a fiction of someone's imagination? No, he's not. We've also got the Nanowak. Hello, Nanowak.
Good afternoon, Clemens.
How are you, Nanowak?
I'm doing very well.
Brilliant. Now, we're looking forward to a very, very good afternoon with Michelle, with the Nanowak, with me, the voice of Admin, but most of all, with you. And there are several ways you can take part in this afternoon's Clancast. As always, we've set up a live page for you. You need to go to jointheclan.com, click on the menu item that says Live Clancast, and you will come through to the one page that matters most of all this afternoon. You'll see there a live player that will work on any audio device at all. It doesn't matter if you've got an iPhone, Flash, whatever. It will work. There's a chat room there. Now, that's one of the very important parts of this afternoon's show. There is a chat room. I'm in there right now. I can see lots of other clanners are in there too, chatting away. It's the place where everyone who wants to be anyone this afternoon on the internet will be. It's the chat room. You can get into the chat room directly from that page. Choose yourself a good, interesting handle. That's a name. There are ways of changing your name. You'll see that fully explained further down the page. But once you get in the chat room, you will be with lots of other clanners and with me. And we'll be monitoring what you say. And if you've got any interesting comments or questions to Michelle, just bung them in there and we will relay them directly to her. However, that's not the only way. You can talk directly to Michelle this afternoon via the miracle of that free communications program, Skype. I'm sure you've already got it on your machine. All you need to do is to send a contact request to Clancast, one word, C-L-A-N-C-A-S-T, Clancast. We'll pick that up straight away, and you know what? As soon as Bob's your uncle, you will be on the air, direct, live with Michelle. Now, Michelle, I guess the question on everybody's mind so far is we've moved onwards, haven't we? We've moved onwards from Chronicles of Ancient Darkness to Gods and Warriors. Yeah. We've left behind the Paleolithic Age.
Mesolithic. Get it right, Admin.
Sorry.
It's not his fault. He's stuck in the 21st century. Don't mind him.
And we've moved into the Bronze Age.
We've moved into the Bronze Age. We have stayed in prehistory, so worry not, clanners. We are still in prehistory. And there are many things that are will be familiar to you in the world of the Bronze Age. But yeah, Chronicles of Ancient Darkness was 6,000 years ago. We've moved on to the Bronze Age 3,500 years ago. And we moved a bit south to the Mediterranean, what today we'd call ancient Greece, although they didn't call it that in those days. And that is not just because I wanted to be somewhere warmer than the Arctic for my research trips. And some of you would have read Gods and Warriors already, but for those who haven't, the hero is Hylas. He's 12. He's a goat herd. He's the lowest of the low. That's how he starts out, anyway. He's not going to be the lowest of the low for very long. And he's growing up in the mountains of Greece with his little sister and his dog and somebody else's goats.
So now, I just want to ask you about this change, because you've said there's about 3,000 years difference between the two worlds. Is that about right?
I can't do the sums, actually. You told me that beforehand. I've never been very good at arithmetic. It's 6,000 years ago, moving on to 3,500 years ago.
So 2,500.
Yeah, 2,500 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what I'm wondering is, how different was that for you to start writing this new age?
Well, in some ways, it was very different, because in Torak's world, they didn't really think about, I don't think, gods and spirits. Well, they thought about spirits, but not so much gods. And when we moved to Hylas's world, I think they did believe in gods, but perhaps they were sort of spirits of the land, of the sea. But perhaps they imagined them in human form. But that seemed to be a big leap for me. It probably isn't a very big leap for the reader. But as I said, some things were quite familiar, because, as I said, Hylas starts out as the lowest of the low. So he, in fact, living in the mountains, is kind of living like a hunter-gatherer, like Torak. You know, there's no one to look after him. He's got no parents. So he's got everything he needs for survival. He's got to find or make from what's around him in the forest and the mountains. So that in a way was my bridge into the Bronze Age. So Hylas's world is, for him, when we start out, I think readers will find that not too dissimilar from Torak's world. But then when we come to the heroine, Pyrrha, she's a little bit different because she's unimaginably rich. She's the daughter of the High Priestess. So there we really are talking something a little bit more sophisticated and different.
Okay. Now, Darkwing, I think there's a lot of chat going on in the chat room. I think it's Darkwing who said, I haven't got Skype. Doesn't matter, Darkwing. You've got a question. You just type it in the chat room and I will see it and I'll read it straight out to Michelle. Now then, if anyone wants to speak to Michelle, I think now is absolutely the right time. Should we see if we can get through to Anna? Anna, if you want to call. Oh, she hasn't got a microphone. Okay. That's a good start, Anna, isn't it? If you've got a question in that case, Anna, type it out and I will read it. Right at the beginning of the book, we're straight into conflict. We're straight into battle. You can almost smell it. It's very vivid.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, how typical is that of the age that you're writing? There's conflict going on all the time, small villages and tribes against each other.
I think it was a pretty tough world to live in, the Bronze Age. It was a pretty tough place to be a child. Hylas is 12. I don't think they really had the concept of childhood in those days. So his camp's been attacked by warriors in black leather armour. His dog's been killed, his sister's gone missing, and as you say, he's struggling along with an arrow in his arm. Mm-hmm. And I don't think this was unusual. I mean, the world was, it was a wild place. There weren't very many people. It was much wetter in Greece and greener than it is today. So I think of it as, you know, the little settlements were like little flickering sparks in the darkness of the wild. Forests full of bears and lions and a few wolves. The sea was full of sharks and monsters. It was never very far away. Storms, earthquakes. It was a dangerous world.
I'm very interested in what bronze means, the significance. We've always, you know, we sort of the Bronze Age, it's a bit of metal. What does it mean? I don't know, really. We don't think about bronze much these days. This is a terrific section right at the beginning of the book. We can give a little bit away.
Yes, let's not set a warning
much.
For spoilers, but yeah. Okay.
Well, I don't think this is a spoiler, okay? And we know that Hylas is being pursued for his life. He doesn't know why. But he's being pursued, and suddenly he gets a glimpse of the person who's chasing him. And this is what you write. You say, what Hylas saw did not resemble a man, but a monster of darkness and bronze. Bronze greaves covered his powerful shins, and a carapace of bronze overlaid his short black rawhide kilt. His breast was hammered bronze, surmounted by bronze shoulder guards of fearsome breadth. He had no face, just an eye slip between a high bronze throat guard, masking nose and mouth, and a black-painted helmet made of scales sliced from the tusks of boars, with bronze cheek guards and a crest of black horsetail. Only his hair showed that he was human. It hung below his shoulders, braided in the snake-like locks of a warrior, each one thick enough to turn a blade. That is one lean, mean, killing machine, isn't it? Is that what bronze means?
I think it's partly what bronze means. I mean, certainly if you were a goat herd being pursued by warriors, it means death. The warriors in question have just disemboweled somebody Hylas once knew, so he knows it means death. I think bronze is one of the things that was a real change, you know, metal from Torak's time when they only used flint. Hylas has never seen bronze until this time because it's only for rich people. But when you think about it, you know, any metal, you've got to wrench it out of the guts of the earth. And if you worshipped the earth, that was a pretty violent thing to do to something you worshipped. So it represents a lot. It represents death. It represents doing things to the earth that maybe you shouldn't be. But for Hylas, right at the beginning, it's just really, really dangerous.
It's very scary. It's very vivid. You know, it sent the hairs on the back of my neck going wild, actually.
It's an amazing
piece of writing.
Took about 3 days to write that particular description,
it's
so I'm quite
very,
glad.
It's very, very scary. Yeah. And it suddenly kicks you in the teeth and it makes you realise what bronze actually meant.
Yeah.
Wolfkeeper, hello.
Hi.
How are you? Okay, I can't hear you very, very well. What you need to do is turn your microphone up. But do ask a question if you've got it, and if Michelle can't hear, I'll try and repeat it.
Is that any better?
It's still pretty faint.
Yeah,
I'm just about getting you.
I was wondering how long it took you to write the book.
You're wondering how long it took me to write the book. That's a good question, Wolfkeeper. It may only take you a couple of days to read, you know, either any of the Chronicles of Ancient Darkness or Gods and Warriors. It actually takes me about a year to write each book. That's partly because I'm quite a slow writer, as I just said, you know, with that paragraph on the Bronze Warrior. You know, it does take a long time. I do a lot of planning first. I also do a lot of research, obviously, you know. For book two of Gods and Warriors, a couple of months ago, I climbed an erupting volcano, and I've been doing various other bits of research. And then the bit I hate is the writing from scratch, you know, just writing onto paper. I use paper and pen, first of all, and then onto a computer. I use a 20th century computer, not a 21st century computer. And I actually save my work onto floppy disks. I should have brought one along. That's an artifact.
What
is a floppy disk? You probably don't know what a floppy disk is, but that's what I save my work onto. But it takes about a year. I've actually, funnily enough, I count up all the hours. I keep a record of all the hours I spend because I like it's encouraging for me. And every single book, including all of the Chronicles and Gods and Warriors, each one takes about the same amount of time. And that doesn't count research. That's just the writing and the rewriting. And that's about 1,000 hours in total. So for each book, it's about 1,000 hours. Takes rather a long time. But you see, I'm pleased if it only takes you a day or so to read, because that means that all that hard work of writing and rewriting has actually worked, because it means, you know, the aim is to make it as readable and exciting as possible. Good question.
I would also like to say thank you for the letter you sent.
You got a letter, did you?
I'm glad it arrived. I'm really glad, because whenever anyone sends me a letter, you know, it comes through the publishers, and you know, it always takes a while. As you know, I'm sure my letter was several weeks or even months after you sent it. But I'm really glad that when I posted it, you never quite know if it's going to turn up. So that's a great pleasure.
That's pretty cool. Thank you very much, Wolfkeeper. Next time, turn your microphone up a bit and we'll hear a lot more from you.
Thanks very much, Wolfkeeper.
Yeah, that was cool. I think we need to hear from the Nanowick at this stage. Nanowick, how are you? What questions have you got?
Yes, indeed. I'm doing very well. I've got a few questions from members on the clan. I actually have one myself, just following on from Wolfkeeper's there. Because, Michelle, you seem to break that down quite neatly into how you write a book. And I was just wondering which aspect of the writing, as in the research, the writing, or which part of the kind of writing process do you really enjoy the most?
I think the one I enjoy most of all is the research.
Yeah.
Because it's not writing.
That's fair
enough. Climbing a volcano, swimming with a dolphin.
Not your everyday lifestyle, really, is it?
It's kind of fun. I'm just taking notes at that stage. Well, I'm not even taking notes when I'm swimming with a dolphin. I'm just trying desperately to remember all my impressions. That's probably the most fun. And I always do those trips on my own. Although in a sense, I'm not on my own because I've got the characters with me. So when I'm up that volcano, I am Hylas, really, thinking
that can lead to some quite interesting situations. I seem to remember when you were researching, I think it was the third book in Chronicles of Ancient Darkness, you had an interesting encounter with a bear.
I did, Soul Eater. I didn't mean to. I'd already had an interesting encounter with a bear way back, you know, which gave me the idea for Wolf Brother years ago. And I went to southern Greenland. Excuse me. Sorry, guys, I'm getting over a cold. So, I went to southern Greenland, and this was in the summer, to do some research on the Inuit for Soul Eater. And it was an area where there weren't supposed to be polar bears, and so I went for a walk.
It was a polar bear?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Jeez. Went for a walk out in out of the settlement, and a couple of hours out of the settlement, I saw this white, unmistakable shape rise up on its hind legs and this long neck sniffing the air. And I have never been so scared because, of course, they eat.
They do, yeah.
They eat people. But the only thing that saved me was the wind.
It didn't smell you, then?
It was blowing in my face, and which told me that it was blowing my scent away from the polar bear.
Yep.
So it didn't see me. So I walked all the way back. Walked, not ran. I Hello,
we got a call from Ashraf. Is that you, Ashraf?
So very, very scary. But just to finish the question, just to finish the question, the bits apart from the research that I really enjoy is when I've written the first draft and I'm revising it and I'm getting to the stage where I've kind of shaped the story and it's taking shape. It's really, really hard work because I've usually missed my deadline by then, so I'm under pressure, but it's fantastic when you've got the story sort of doing what you want.
It's that moment
to
when you can see everything kind of turning out the way it's meant to.
Yeah,
and you just have to push that extra step.
There's a dark period when you're two-thirds of the way through, and it's a mess still, which is where I am with book two at the moment.
Not for much longer, I bet.
I hope not. No, it's always like that.
We've got a couple of people here. We've got Zoe, we've got Ashraf. Hello, Ashraf, how are you?
Hello, hi, how are you?
Very good. Now, you're in Bahrain. Can't hear you terribly well, but you're in Bahrain, aren't you?
Yes, I am. I'm actually Egyptian, but I live in here, in Bahrain.
Well, I think Michelle was recently in Bahrain.
No, I have never been to Bahrain. I've been in Dubai, but not Bahrain.
The background of the cover says.
I've been in Egypt, though, many times,
yes,
but you're also quite faint. Can we?
Hello, wait.
But I can hear you just.
Hello, is that better?
Yeah,
a little bit, yeah.
Can everyone hear me?
Yes, hello, and that's you, Zoe, as well.
I can. You're both pretty faint. I don't know. I think we've got a problem here in central London. Admin's looking puzzled. But don't worry. If you shout, I can still hear you. Who wants to go first?
Zoe, you go first.
Oh, thank you. I'm in England.
Excellent. Hello, Zoe. You're coming through better now. You're both coming through better.
Okay. I was in Bath the other day, Michelle.
Ah, you were in Bath. Well, so was I, just in case anyone was wondering what we're talking about. I did the Bath Festival of Children's Literature. It feels like years ago, but I think it was only last weekend or the weekend before last.
Yeah, I was the first one to have my book signed.
Ah, yes, I remember. Nice. I remember.
Yeah. Michelle, do you have an address I can write to?
Publisher
is the best one.
The publisher's address is the best one to write to because I'm not always at home, and I tend not to give out my home address. But if you write to, I mean, if you want to write about Gods and Warriors, or either way, you can send write to Puffin Books, and I think the address will be in.
It's in the front of the book.
I can't remember the postcode offhand, but it's Puffin Books, 80 The Strand, London. Actually, maybe I can. WC2RORL, I think it is. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
That's a pleasure.
Thanks, Zoe. And Ashraf, you're still there. Have you got another question for Michelle?
Yes, I am. Rumour has a book two called The Burning Shadow.
Yes. Yes, rumour has it, and rumour is correct. Well done for eliciting that one. It wasn't The Burning Shadow until a few weeks ago. It was just book two.
Really?
And I had various ideas. At one stage, it was going to be The Lion of Thalacria, because there's a lion in it. But The Burning Shadow just seemed, you know, sometimes when you're writing, you don't have a title to begin with, and then something comes through, and I lived with that for a while, and I thought, oh, I really like that. And then eventually I plucked up courage and told it to my editor, and she said, ooh. And that's a good sign when people make that noise.
Okay, but there's something weird. I saw it on the internet, on the online shop. They wrote The Burning Shadow, like, from August. It was a long time ago.
Did they? Well, yeah, no, August, that's about right. That was when I told my editor. Time at the moment has a little bit of a non-meaning for me because I've spent about 6 weeks talking in schools and festivals and things and not writing. So that was the last time I was actually seriously working on The Burning Shadow. So, yes.
Okay, last question. What should I expect from the second book?
Good question.
What should you expect from the second? You're very good. You're very good. You're eliciting an awful lot of information here. I don't want to give you too much, but I think you heard me say that a few months ago I climbed an erupting volcano. And I think you heard me say that there's a lion in the Burning Shadow. So I think that's about all I want to say about it at the moment. I don't want to give too much away. But, I'm in the middle of it at the moment. And we've moved on from Gods and Warriors. We're in a different part of the Mediterranean. that's about all I'm going to give
you. Very big hints.
But since you're Egyptian, I will just say that we will, later in book four be getting to Egypt.
Nice. Cool. Nice.
Yeah,
that's like in 2015? Right. 13, 14?
Something book like four that. It's always
coming,
confusing.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, book three will be on Crete, which is, of course, called Keftu in the books. And then book four is in Egypt.
Very cool. So, Ashraf, yeah. You've got a lot. You're going to go a long way.
Yeah,
Ashraf.
You're going to go a long
you're
way.
You're going to be a lawyer, aren't you, I think.
Very impressive.
Thank you, amazing. Michelle. And last clan class was like 4 years ago, and it's really good to be back. You know.
Excellent. I'm so glad you've tuned in or logged on or whatever the term is.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I've been actually in the British Museum this morning for the last 3 hours. So I've been in the Bronze Age. So excuse me if my terminology isn't 21st century.
Floppy disks and all that
stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, cool. Thanks, Ashraf.
Thanks very much.
See you later.
Cheers, Ashraf.
Mountain Goat, are you on there? Mountain Goat.
Oh, hey.
Hello.
Hi. Oh. Good. We've sorted out our sound. I can hear you.
I think
properly.
We have, yeah.
I'm nice and clear, am I?
You
yes,
are very clear.
You are, yeah.
Yeah. Hello. Where are you, actually, Mountain Goat?
England.
England, excellent. Where am I?
I've got a question.
Excellent.
Why did you decide to write the books on sort of early Bronze Age as opposed to my summary, as is like pretty typical of authors, sort of going from Minoan and Phoenician history as opposed to my summary?
Well, actually, it's not early Bronze Age. It is late Bronze Age that Gods and Warriors is set. So I chose... Choosing the time to set Gods and Warriors was a little bit more complicated than for Chronicles. Chronicles, we really don't know that much. So, I just chose a time in the Mesolithic in 6,000 years ago. For the Bronze Age, we know much more, as I'm sure you know. And we know an awful lot more for Egypt, so I had to be careful to dovetail it in. But I knew there were certain things I wanted. I wanted there to be chariots and horses on mainland Greece. And so I couldn't go back to the early Bronze Age because there's no evidence that there were any. And I wanted Hylas to interact with the Cretans, the Minoans, as we call them. And I wanted my heroine to be Minoan. So I went for the late Bronze Age. And so if anyone... We're going to get into archaeology here, so if anyone's interested in it. Hylas is actually from the Mycenaean culture, but the very early Mycenaean culture, and Pyrrha is Minoan. So I'm not sure if I'm answering your question, but it's because of those... What I was trying to do was I wanted a period where we had the wonderful palaces, the what they call the New Palace era of the Minoan civilization, which was really the pinnacle, this amazing, you know, gold jewelry and wonderful sacrificial vessels. But also Hylas's culture is fairly advanced as well. So we had the bronze daggers and the chariots. Although I reckon that the Keftians or the Minoans would have, Pyrrha's lot, would have looked down on Hylas's lot because they were so much more sophisticated. So there's a lot more to that. It took me about a week to choose the timing because you've got various volcanic eruptions going on, which I had to take account of. But I found ways of getting around them. In the back of Gods and Warriors, there's a little bit more in my author's note, which explains a little bit more how I chose, or you know what, how I approached the names and that sort of thing. Have I answered your question?
Yeah.
Sort of. Yeah.
That's cool. Sly Face, can you hear us, Sly Face?
Yeah.
Hello. How are you?
Okay.
Whoops. You just dropped the microphone or something.
Did you just fall over?
You still there?
Can you hear Michelle? You're talking to Michelle right now.
Hi.
Hello. Hi. How are you?
Well, I haven't exactly finished drafting lawyers yet, so I don't have a question pertaining to that.
Well, I'm sure Michelle just likes talking to you,
it's
actually.
It's quite nice to know that you're actually... So you're in the process of reading Gods and Warriors, are you?
Yeah. I've had it for, like, a month, longer than a month, so I haven't started it.
Okay.
Like a couple of days ago.
Yep.
I need a charger.
Thank you, Sly Face. Really nice to talk to you.
Well, well done for getting in touch, because there's no way I could manage the technology to do what you've just done.
That's brilliant. Well done.
Yes.
Is it? How would the animals be? How would the animals be keen in Gods and Warriors? Sorry, I've been away for a bit.
How would the animals be? What? I'm sorry.
How will the animals be key in the rest of the Gods and Warriors series?
How will the animals be key? How yeah. will yeah. how important will they be? Well, they're basically three important animals in the series. It's going to Gods and Warriors is going to be five books.
Okay.
They're going to be three key animals who'll make friends with Hylas and Pyrrha in various ways. In Gods and Warriors book one, which is also called Gods and Warriors, we meet Spirit, the dolphin. That's the first key animal. In the second book, The Burning Shadow, we're going to meet the second animal, which is a lion. Okay. She's actually a lion cub when we meet her. And in the third book, we're going to meet the third animal, which is a falcon. So I don't want to say too much about them, but actually, just one thing I would say is that if you're a child in the Bronze Age and you're on the run from a powerful warrior clan yeah. and you want to make friends with three animals, those are good friends to have. Because when you think about it, the dolphin is, next to people, the cleverest creature probably in the world. The falcon is definitely the fastest creature, still is, in the world. And the lion is one of the strongest. So, and there are other reasons why those animals kind of leapt out at me when I was doing the research. You know, sometimes you don't always plan things, they just happen. And those, very, very early on, I realised that those were going to be the three animals. So it's not a question of one animal per book. They'll be coming in different ways. Sometimes there'll be two animals. But always I'm going to be writing in certain parts in the story from their point of view. I wasn't going to for the dolphin when I was starting to write Gods and Warriors. I thought, oh, I mustn't be like Wolf Brother. You know, I mustn't be, you know, it'll be too similar and I mustn't write from the dolphin's point of view. And then I started doing the research. And I swam with some dolphins and I thought, don't be stupid, Michelle, you know, this is just too interesting and too amazing. You know, what it's like to be a dolphin is just so fantastic.
I really enjoyed Chronicles of Ancient Darkness as well. I really love them.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Well, you know, I think part of the fun there was writing from a wolf's point of view. And
thank you for seeing me in Bath, by the way. Thank you.
Ah, excellent. All these people from Bath, fantastic.
Nice. Yes. Yeah. Anna's got a question here. She has got a question, but she hasn't got a microphone, unfortunately, so I'll just tell you. She says, what inspired you to be an author?
What inspired me to be an author? Well, I didn't set out to be an author. That's the first thing. I just loved writing stories. I wrote my first story when I was five on my mum's typewriter, and that's called Ebony the Mouse Goddess. So you see, an early interest in animals and goddesses.
As well.
Yeah. So I just liked writing stories. And when I was at school, I used to write stories. It didn't actually occur to me that I maybe might want to make that my living until I was at university. And I was actually studying biochemistry. But I thought, well, you know, I've read lots of books, so maybe I can write one. And it turned out to be a little bit harder than that, I thought. So then it took a good few years to really learn how to write, and kept sending off books and getting them sent back with rejections. That's what happens to most people. And then eventually got published. So it took a while to realise that, yes, this is what I want to do. You know, some people are lucky. They just know immediately. My older sister knew from, I think she was about 12, that she wanted to be a doctor. And she's a doctor. So she always knew what she wanted to do. I wasn't like that. So it can take a while, but I wouldn't do anything else now.
No, absolutely. I want to ask you something about Hylas. Thank you very much for that.
Yes,
and
thanks.
I know we've got Dalton on here. Dalton, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Okay, you go ahead, then I've got a question after you.
Hi, Mrs. Paver.
Hi.
I'm very nervous right now because I've never spoken to an author.
Oh, please don't be nervous.
where are you, Dalton?
I am in Arapahoe, Nebraska.
Okay. Wow, that's amazing. Isn't that fantastic that
you're
I'm
welcome.
Talking to this? I don't know what time it is, but thank you for getting in touch. That's amazing.
Uh-huh. Well, first of all, I would like to thank you very much, Ms. Paver, for signing all the copies of the books that you have sent me from the contest that I previously joined, which was the virtual museum contest and the trailer contest. I really appreciated those books that you gave me. You should have seen the excitement when they came in the mail.
Well, I'm just so grateful to you for telling me this, because, you know, sometimes I sign books and then they go off into the ether, yeah. You know, so it's fantastic to know that they've arrived. That, thank you really for sharing that.
The mail was actually pretty quick, and I was surprised that a couple of days it just came in.
Wow, that is impressive. It doesn't always happen, I can tell you.
But I love the omnibus edition, which had the three books of the Chronicles of Ancient Darkness inside of it, and Oathbreaker, and then Dark Matter. I still need to get Gods and Warriors, though.
Right, okay, well, we'll have to work on that, or rather you will.
Yeah.
Okay, Dalton, White Spirit Rose in the chat room says, she, I think it probably is she, likes your voice a lot.
Wow, there you go.
That made me even more nervous.
Well, you don't sound nervous at all, I can tell you. So it's not coming through on the microphone.
I'm actually just using my Android phone. This is my first time having a smartphone. So like you with the technology, this is the first time with technology with me. So
okay, well, you're one up on me. I haven't got a smartphone. I do texting, and that's it.
White Spirit Rose just asked how much longer you've got left. We're halfway through. Can you believe it? We are actually halfway through this clan kill. So, guys, if you want to ask questions, you've got to Skype in right now. Go ahead, Dalton.
Okay. Yes, go ahead.
I had two questions, actually. My first question was, when writing in your stories, I've recently noticed that you've done mostly historical events, like for Chronicles of Ancient Darkness, you did the Stone Age.
Yeah.
Then with Dark Matter, you did ghost stories. And then with your recent one, you've done Greek mythology.
Yeah.
Have you ever taken into consideration of staying home and creating your own world?
Ah, staying, you mean creating my own world, you mean fantasy, real fantasy?
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, only briefly when someone has asked a question like that, and I don't really know why, but pure fantasy, you know, like if I was to write about flying horses or something that physically couldn't happen, has no interest for me at the moment. I'm not going to rule it out, because as a writer you don't rule anything out, but it doesn't interest me for some reason, and I'm making it much harder for myself. I like to write stories that could possibly have happened. And I know maybe people are going to be thinking, well, wait a minute, you know, wolf brother, demonic bear or something. But that was because it was set 6,000 years ago. And from Torak's point of view, maybe the bear, you know, was it possessed by a demon. But there's always a sort of 21st century explanation. So I don't write. I find it difficult to really get engaged with something that couldn't actually have happened. So I think the answer, Dalton, is no. It would be a lot easier. I wouldn't have to do all this research. I could just sit there and make up dragons and stuff. It would be so much easier. And I'd write many more books, but I just can't get interested in that. Although I like reading them. You know, I don't have an objection to reading them, but they've got to be pretty realistic. Interesting question.
Thank you, Dawn.
You had a second question, didn't you?
Okay, fire ahead.
My second question was, I actually have a... two recent book projects that I'm working on, because I do want to become a writer as well, because I love writing.
Mm.
And the first one's called The Dragons of Summer Wind.
Uh-huh.
And then the second one is called The Flight of the Mystic Owl. Right. And I was wondering, what's the best approach in publishing your novel, like not to make yourself look like a fool in the public and in your publishing? Like, what's the best approach to introducing yourself into the world of writing?
Well, I don't know in America, but certainly in England, there are, and I'm sure they'll be the same in America, there are books like The Writer's Handbook, which will give you, it's like a directory of the publishers and agents, and it tells you how they like things submitted to them. I mean, I can pretty much tell you now that most publishers don't want you to send a whole manuscript. You know, and so if you look up, say, I don't know, Penguin Books or something, it'll probably say a letter plus a synopsis and maybe the first chapter or something like that. Mm-hmm. You'd have to look it up. But if you go to one of those directories, or indeed the publishers' websites, to see how they want stuff to be submitted, you will almost certainly be giving yourself an advantage over other people, because at least then you're putting it in a form in which, you know, they might actually have a look at it. I'm sorry not to be too encouraging, because, you know, they have piles and piles of manuscripts, but presentation is quite important, and don't write it in violet ink, and don't bind it in a fancy way. They just like loose paper, or probably nowadays they like it, you know, electronically submitted, but I'm not the best person to ask about that.
Floppy disks, possibly.
not floppy disks, but yeah, I mean, and I'm afraid that, you know, just find out how they want the work submitted, and then it's a question of taking your confidence in both hands and submitting it. But only submit it when you think it's the absolute best you can do.
Yeah.
So,
cool.
So good luck with that, okay, Dalton. Well,
thank you very much for your time, Mrs. Favour.
That's a great pleasure.
Thank you very
and
much.
The best of luck with your writing.
Thank you, Dalton. Keep at it. And now, Michael, can you hear us, Michael? Are you there, Michael?
I think so.
Yeah.
I'm getting something.
Yeah, I can just about hear you. What do you want to ask Michelle?
What about now?
That's better.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Turning me down. Oh, damn it.
Wait a minute.
Hello?
Yeah, I can hear you. Go ahead to Michelle.
Yeah.
All right.
Hi.
I actually gave this one to Slyface earlier to ask, but then she didn't, and she was very confused.
Okay.
I didn't go to ask. It's completely unrelated to anything.
Right.
But what do you think is the meaning of life?
What do I think is the meaning of life?
That's kind of related
why
to everything,
not ask
isn't
a good
it?
Question? How can I put this? Well, I'll give it to you straight. I don't think there is a meaning to life. I don't think life has a meaning. I don't believe in anything supreme in terms of a supreme being or anything like that. So, you see, I used to be a biochemist. So back in the old days, I was isolating DNA in the laboratory, and that effectively is life. You know, it exists to make more of itself. So that may sound a bit bleak, but funnily enough, I don't find it that bleak. I don't think there is a particular meaning to life, but I do think life, everyday life, has a sort of meaning just by going for a walk with and feeding some crows, which I did this morning, looking at the sky, enjoying the trees, maybe enjoying friendships and things. I don't think ultimately that goes to one particular aim. Wow, we're getting very heavy here.
No,
but you did
very
ask.
Important, yeah.
So there we are.
I think that's quite an interesting answer, given that most of the books you've written, not just the children's ones, have quite a heavy supernatural element to them.
I know. And thanks, Nanowet, because people do ask me sometimes, do you believe in all these spirits and things that you write about? And no, I don't really.
But that is interesting.
I believe in the possibility of the human brain. I mean, the human brain is, we think, one of the most complicated systems in the universe. And it can create gods and goddesses. And Hylas sees them. And, you know, he believes in them. And they exist for him. That's
really
what I believe
answer. In. In that case, I'm just going to jump ahead quickly and ask my own question. I probably shouldn't do technically, but I can't resist.
Okay, the Nanowak is pushing in here, as he often does.
He's boiling.
Sorry, guys, can't help it. I think it's no secret that my personal favourite of your books is Dark Matter.
Aha.
The horror story.
Ghost
I really
story,
enjoyed it.
Please. Ghost story.
Ghost story.
Not a horror
ghost story. Well, there are elements which are pretty scary.
There are indeed, yeah.
I got the impression, very much reading it, that you were drawing upon not necessarily a personal experience, but on something which was very tangible. And certainly the way in which Dark Matter ends, I don't want to spoil it for you if you haven't read it, it certainly jumps the border from the supernatural world into the physical world, let's say that.
Yes, it does.
What was your inspiration for the, I'm not sure what to call it really, for the ghost, let's say, from Dark Matter?
Dark Matter, I just wanted to write a ghost story, pure and simple. I wanted to scare the hell out of the reader. That was all I wanted to do. Yeah. And when you're writing a ghost story, I think you have to decide very early on, before you even start writing, is it a real ghost or is it just a figment of someone's imagination? You know, the second type is the kind of ghost story where, you know, the reader's constantly thinking, you know, is he just mad or is the ghost real? When I started to write Dark Matter, I decided very, you know, before I even started, yep, it's a real ghost. But what has really interested me is since I wrote it, a lot of people, including people studying it at university and things, have said, the interesting thing about Dark Matter is that you're never quite sure whether it's all in his mind or not. And I just think, really? Even the dog sees the ghost. how much more real
how much
do you
more
want
real
me
can
to
it
make
be?
This ghost?
Sure.
Yeah.
The really interesting thing for me was that I studied Norse culture at university, and actually the character, again, I'm kind of skirting around calling it a ghost, but hell with it. The ghost in Dark Matter actually is a phenomenon in Norse culture.
Yes. That's right.
The Drygo, which I found really interesting.
Absolutely. I mean, I did base the, as you said, the, to answer your question, I mean, the inspiration, because we're set, it's set in, you know, the high Arctic, I did base it partly on Nordic ideas of ghosts. And in fact, just recently I was listening to something or reading an article, mm-hmm. Which put forward the idea, a really simple one that hadn't really occurred to me, that because it's dark for so long, I mean, it's dark for months up in the Nordic countries in the winter, people do sleep for much longer there. I mean, I know that because I've asked people up there and they say, yes, it's really hard to stop yourself from sleeping 12 hours a day because, you know, it's dark. Therefore, they dream more. Therefore, they have many more vivid beliefs about ghosts.
That is interesting.
And, okay. And I'd never really put all that together. But yeah, definitely the inspiration came from the Norse culture.
I just want to bring in the Investigator S. Are you there, yes. Investigator S?
Thanks, Nanoi.
Oh, yes, hello.
Hello, how are you?
Hi, I'm good, thanks. I'm a little nervous.
Oh, don't worry. Well, it's always silly to say don't worry and don't be nervous, but you don't sound nervous. And I was nervous at the beginning. Sorry, this is Michelle. I was nervous at the beginning of this. So I'll just keep chattering until you've remembered your question.
Okay, well, I know my question. I should probably also say my username is Medicine Pouch.
Medicine Pouch, nice one.
Well done, Medicine Pouch.
Okay.
They've been talking in the chat room all afternoon whether you were going to get your courage up and Skype in or not. Well done, you finally did it.
Yeah, and I'm also supposed to say hi for Space Wolf.
Okay.
Hi to Space Wolf, fantastic. Gosh, you're coming through loud and clear. Where are you calling from, as a matter of interest?
South UK.
South UK, excellent.
Yeah.
Excellent.
I had a question that I didn't get to ask at the Superfan event because
right.
I forgot. It's something to do with Chronicles of Ancient Darkness, so we're going to backtrack a little.
Fine, no problem.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
It's about Outcast.
Uh-huh.
I believe it was in, yeah. When Torak is on the edge of the clan meet, Sian says that she senses a soul leader to the marrow, and I was wondering if she was definitely sensing Torak or if maybe it was Cheshru nearby.
Well, that's a question, isn't it? Yeah. That's a really good question. And it's one I'm not going to answer.
Okay.
Because it could be either. It could be either. That's the thing. And there are some things, as you know, that I want to leave to the reader's imagination. It could be either or both, actually. So a good question, and my goodness, it shows how what a detailed reading of Outcast you've had. But I'm sure you've already sort of thought of that answer in your own head. You probably just wanted to nail it down, but I'm refusing to be nailed down on that one.
Okay.
So a very nice try. Very nice try, Medicine Pouch.
Thank you very much, Medicine Pouch. You mentioned Outcast, Hylas, as an outsider.
Yeah, Hylas, yeah.
Quite similar. I mean, when we first meet him in Gods and Warriors, he's being chased, he's in fear of his life, and there is this almost horrific scene, actually, where not exactly a friend of his, but certainly another outsider that he knows, has been killed by these strange people who are pursuing Hylas. He doesn't know why. And he's just looking at this corpse that kind of got caught halfway down a mountainside. And Hylas thinks his ghost, that's the other guy, the his friend's name is Skyros.
It's Hylas and Skyros.
His ghost would need help to ease its passing. But Hylas couldn't risk burying him or doing the rites. Sorry, Skyros, he muttered. Rules of survival. Don't help someone if they can't help you. He's not a terribly nice person to begin with, is he?
Hylas, no. Well, I think he is because he's my hero, but no,
but he's a tough guy.
He's got to be tough, you know. Yeah. That's his rule of survival. Don't help someone if they can't help you, and that's the only way he can really look after himself and his little sister. So, no, I think at one of the festivals, it might have been Edinburgh, someone asked me, you know, if Hylas and Torak met, how would they get on?
Yeah.
And that's an incredibly good question because Torak. I mean, Torak had been brought up by his father, and so he has much more of a sense of right and wrong than Hylas has. Hylas was just found on a mountain aged about 5, he doesn't really know how old he is, with his little sister. So he's had to, you know, lie and cheat and steal to survive. So if, I think if he met Torak, to begin with, they wouldn't like each other very much. I don't think Torak would like Hylas very much. And I'm not sure that Hylas would respect Torak.
Would they fight? Would they fight?
Well, they might do, depending on how they met.
Who'd win?
don't know who'd win, but I think if they had to make common cause against an enemy, they'd start to respect each other pretty quickly. Mm. Are you still there, Medicine Pouch?
Yeah, I am.
Did you have another question?
No, sorry, I just wasn't sure if I was supposed to hang up or not.
Don't worry. No, we've been rabbiting on, but thank you very much for staying with us, and thank you for asking your question and having the courage to come on board, because it can't have been easy with all that technology. I wouldn't be able to do it.
Thanks, Madsen Patch. Now then, we've got less than 15 minutes. I can't believe the time has gone so quickly.
No, it's gone quickly.
If you want to speak to Michelle, you know how to do it. You Skype Clancast, or one word, Skype Clancast. And you will be straight through to Michelle. And indeed, to the Nanoac. I haven't had time to really watch what's happening in the chat room. I see we've got some really nice old friends there. Half-Blood Ryan is there.
Oh, hello, Half-Blood
Ryan.
Yeah,
good to see you. Nanoac, have you been keeping up with things in the chat room?
I've been keeping an eye on it. There's quite a few questions right now about some of the pronunciations, both in Gods and Warriors and mm-hmm. in the Chronicles of Ancient Darkness.
Sure.
People are pretty clear how hard this is pronounced, I think. Yes. There was a few questions over Saiyan, or at least that's how I'm choosing to pronounce it.
I know. I apologise, hand on heart, for choosing that name. That is actually an Old Norse name.
Yep.
So it is pronounced Saiyan. Well, that's how I pronounce it. It doesn't really matter how you pronounce them. But yeah, I didn't really realise when I wrote that how difficult a name it is. I think the others in Chronicles are reasonably straightforward. Although sometimes people ask me about Fincedin.
Yes, somebody was asking about that just now, actually.
Yeah, because I think that goes back to... There was a radio adaptation by the BBC, and although they checked with me, they went and called him Fincedin.
Oh, no.
Which,
no.
I mean, of course, Fincedin being the sort of... It is actually Fincedin. Him being the sort of person he wouldn't mind if you addressed him as Fincedin, provided you were respectful. He wouldn't mind at all. But yeah, it's Fincedin.
Fincedin. Got that one cleared up.
Yeah. Any questions about pronunciation for Gods and Warriors? It's Hylas.
It is Hylas.
Yep. Hylas, Pyrrha, Acastus.
Acastus.
Telamon.
Yep. Funny you mention Acastus, he's got to be my favourite character from Gods and Warriors, actually.
Good. I'm glad about that. He's one of my favourites, too. I haven't finished with Acastus yet.
I had a feeling he hadn't.
Oh, no. No, he's... that's all I'm going to say, I haven't finished with him yet. Good.
Strong hint there.
Just pushing on a little bit, and just a few more pages in the book, and I'm really, really careful about not giving any spoilers away. But we know that
otherwise we will kill you.
I know. Yeah, well, don't, please. I mean, there's a million and one different deaths that you could create, I'm sure.
And I do have a Stone Age axe, so watch it.
But Hylas is running for his life. He ends up in, I won't say exactly where, but he ends up looking at someone who had been killed by the people who are chasing him, and this is a description of it. They laid him out, this is his friends and relatives, on a reed mat with his sickle and spear, having killed both weapons, by breaking them in two, so that his spirit could make use of them. For the same reason, they'd smashed his cup and bowl and strangled his dog, which lay nearby, ready to pad at his heels into the afterlife. And this must have been one of the richer peasants, because in the far corner huddled a dead slave. Like the dog, the slave had been killed so that he could attend his master. I'm going to stop there, because if you keep on reading, something extremely creepy happens after that. So creepy, I mustn't tell you.
No, you
but
mustn't.
But so creepy, it will completely freak you out. Now, one of the things that I think people say about your writing is that it does create a wonderful, powerful atmosphere. I think you've got a little bit of it just there. How do you manage that? How do you do that? Is it just the research, or what is it that makes that world?
Well, firstly, yeah, you need to do the research. I needed to know about death rites and how people approached burying someone. And say, for example, without giving spoilers away, they build a tomb. What's the inside of the tomb like? And then I have to imagine myself in it. You know, and I mean, I was just saying I was spending time in the British Museum this morning, and lovely sort of dusty artifacts in there. Well, they're not dusty, but they look a bit dusty and certainly faded and ancient and thousands of years old. There are, for example, clay coffins from Hylas's time in the British Museum, and they look like baths, really, bathtubs. And you've got to imagine that when it was new, it was brightly coloured, painted with people dancing and making sacrifices, and it had a person in it, you know, folded up. And so, yes, I do the research, and then I have to imagine, okay, I'm there, and what's it like being in a tomb, an alive person, but finding yourself in a tomb, perhaps a bit smelly, very quiet, because you're inside a tomb, terrified of spirits, terrified of ghosts. And so there's an element of then imagining myself into that place and being Hylas. And that's the bit I really enjoy, because then I've got all the research at my fingertips, and now I can imagine, okay, this is what he's feeling, and this is what's going to happen next.
And another thing you do really well right from the beginning is we're straight into action. You write action sequences really well. They're very exciting. It keeps you moving along like a Bourne film or something like that. It's bang, 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 total action all the time. Sometimes it's very bloody, very gory. What sort of films do you like? Do you like fast-paced action movies that are bloody and gory?
Sometimes. I don't... I mean, I love The Lord of the Rings. I love those movies. I'm not terribly fond of very, very violent films. I don't think you need to be in your face that violent. I don't think my books are that violent, but they just occasionally have a suggestion of what could happen. I also like the really slow, quiet films where there's lots of the natural world and that sort of thing. My mind's gone blank as to what films I've seen recently that I've really enjoyed. But you're right, I do like films. I like scary ones. They're not that many very scary films, I don't think. I mean, frightening in the terms of ghost films. But atmospheric, yes, definitely. And I think I must have watched an awful lot of them as a child, because I do tend to think in filmic terms.
So favourite film?
Favourite film? Don't really have one. No, can't think of a favourite. Several of them, but they're probably far too old for many of the people watching. You wouldn't know them. But actually, yeah, there's a couple which you may not know, but old Japanese ghost stories. Brilliant. There's one called The Black Cat. I think it's called Kuraneko in Japanese. And it's amazing. Didn't have many special effects, but my goodness, you didn't need them. So I don't know what sounds we're getting through here.
Anna, well, that is someone else who wants to talk to you. Anna just wants to know about the death marks. We're going back to Chronicles again.
Yes.
Death marks. Is it just an idea that you came up with, or was it really a tradition?
Oh, that's a nice question. Now, I didn't really make up death marks, although I think I gave them that name. That's the same for an awful lot of the beliefs in both Chronicles of Ancient Darkness and Gods and Warriors. Because we know some beliefs, but obviously for the Stone Age, we don't know many beliefs at all, because they didn't have writing, so they didn't leave us any traces, written traces. So for Chronicles, and also for Gods and Warriors, I've taken beliefs from more recent times, from more recent hunter-gatherers in Chronicles' case, perhaps the Inuit, the Ainu in Japan, the Aborigines in Australia, some of the African tribes, American Indian tribes. And all over the world, quite often you find when someone's died, there is some sort of a mark. I think there was some kind of death mark in Malaysia, some Malaysian traditions, I might be wrong about that, where they mark the person just so that the spirit, that many, many traditional peoples get worried about the spirit not finding its body again or getting lost. And in many cultures, people are believed to have more than one soul. In fact, I think Westerners are quite unusual in believing we only have one soul. So in Hylas's world, Torak's world, we have three. And so it just seemed natural then. I adapted the idea of death marks from other existing beliefs and then called them death marks. But the actual form of them, you know, the circles on the forehead, the breastbone, and then the heels, that I made up. But the use of red ochre is certainly not made up. I mean, red ochre has been a sacred substance for well over 50,000 years.
And is that true then about what you know, comes in Gods and Warriors about breaking somebody's tools and killing their dog?
That I didn't make up.
And that happens?
That happens in many, what they call pastoral cultures, cultures where you've got some farming, which is opposed to the hunter-gathering cultures. The Vikings, for example, in Viking burials, you often find swords or daggers that have been bent over. They've been killed. And we know that they've been killed because the Vikings obviously left some writing behind and smashed goblets in the Mycenaean period, which was Hylas's period.
Nice.
So I've adapted those beliefs, and they would, definitely many, many cultures, sadly, have killed dogs. Horses were often killed, slave girls, slaves. The whole idea being to take you into the afterlife. That's why
a waste of slaves, isn't it, really?
It wasn't regarded as a waste of slaves, because you were going to use them in the afterlife. Right. I mean, the ancient Egyptians had, would mummify food as a way of taking your food into the afterlife. That's a slightly nicer way of doing things.
Are you there, Mountain Goat?
I think Mountain Goat's just called in to listen.
Very good.
Oh, okay. That's fine.
Hope you're enjoying it.
No, yes. I'm just going to jump in quickly. We've just had one question from Zoe of the Whale Clan and Half-Blood Ryan.
Ah, the Whale Clan. Welcome.
Now, they're asking about any film adaptations. I think they mean Dark Matter Chronicles and Gods and Warriors.
Yes.
They're really just interested to find out what they can do from you.
Yes. Well, nothing as yet for Gods and Warriors, although, we'll keep you posted. Yep. Dark Matter, we've done a film deal, but that means that we're hoping that it will go to the next stage of actually being made into a film. But now is the time, which is this sort of tunnel you go through with film deals, which is called development, and that's when they're working up the script and trying to work out whether they can make the film. I have high hopes of that one. And then Chronicles, as some of you will know from years ago, originally I did a film deal with Hollywood. And that went into the dark tunnel of development. And eventually, after many years, we amicably decided to go our separate ways. There is some more interest in that. I don't know how much further I can announce at the moment.
Well, I think we could say we're feeling pretty cool about that.
Yeah, we're feeling like that there might well be something happening on Chronicles.
Brilliant.
That would be great.
Yeah, it really would be.
So, yeah.
I've just got one more quick one just to squeeze in before the end. This one comes from Star Shower. And what Starshire is asking is, if a person, I think she means you, Michelle, if you're working on a deadline, a writing deadline, it's a month away, how would you suggest not to burn out after writing consistently for a month, during writing consistently for a month, rather?
Well, I'd love to know, actually, because I'm about 2 months away from my deadline, and there's no way on earth I'm going to make it. to be serious, because I know what it's like. I will be shortly entering the time when, I'll be gradually upping the writing to maybe 10 hours a day. And burning out is a real danger, even when you're really enjoying the writing. You have to be very practical about it. You have to approach it as you would any really heavy-duty task. Yep. You have to eat well. And I know, at the risk of sounding like your mother, but this is really, really true. I do know my brain biochemistry. You have to eat plenty of protein and vegetables and fruit, because that is really seriously, don't exist on coffee and donuts. It is not going to do your brain and your writing any good. So eating well, getting lots of exercise. Luckily, I live near a forest now, and so quite often yesterday I had two walks, one in the morning, one in the evening.
Wow, very jealous.
Just, going out there, making friends with the crows, listening to the owls. That, just getting out. Apart from that, it's just hard. It's just hard to keep yourself motivated and to not despair of just think to that last page when you can write the end and have a glass of champagne.
There's a lot of people here motivating you right now.
Yeah, you are actually. You're helping me tremendously, because I have to confess I wasn't feeling very great this morning, because I haven't actually done any writing for the last 6 weeks, and I was feeling very miserable. So I went to the British Museum to kind of perk myself up, but you've all done a much better job, so thank you.
Big hugs.
Thank you, yes, absolutely.
Big hugs really coming at you internationally.
Big shot in the arm, so thanks. Burning Shadow will thank you.
Absolutely. Guys, what can I say? I know that everyone listening right now does want to send Michelle a big hug. If only, because we want to read the second book in the series.
Yeah, so do I.
So do you. So do we all. Thank you very much, Michelle. Last hour has been absolute heaven.
Well, I've thoroughly enjoyed
many,
it.
Many people.
I've really enjoyed it. Thanks for everybody, who's got in touch, from Nebraska to Bahrain. Absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, thanks. It has been fantastic. And we're going to do it again.
Yes.
I don't know. We've left it too long.
We have.
Maybe 2 or 3 months.
Yeah.
Maybe just after Christmas.
By then, I will have handed in Gods and Warriors. I mean, The Burning Shadow. Yeah. So I'll be looking even more hollow-eyed. But happy.
Thank you, Nanny White, for being with us.
No worries, guys.
Thanks,
you are real after all.
Yes.
I am indeed.
We've heard you. We can prove it. And mostly, thank you, everyone, for listening this afternoon. It's been a fantastic time. I've enjoyed it. I know Michelle. She's going to go away bright-eyed and bushy-tailed.
I am.
She's going to finish the rest of that book immediately. Well, not quite. But she will. She will. Don't worry.
Thanks very much, everybody.
This has been the Clancast live and right in your face all over the world. We're going to do it again really soon. Thank you, Naniwak. And thank you, Michelle. And may the gods and warriors go with you.